Dear students, today's class is on bone loss and patterns of bone destructions. We already seen about periodontal disease, how the periodontal pocket and periodontitis progresses, or how the periodontal pocket formation occurs. So today's class we will see about how bone loss occurs and what are all the patterns of bone destructions. Today's learning outcomes are define various bone loss patterns, list 5 different bone changes in periodontal disease, classify 3 different intrabony defects, differentiate various bone loss patterns in radiographs. So coming on to the content, what are all the things we are going to see today is starts with introduction, pathogenesis of pocket formation, pathways of bone destructions, characteristics of bone destructions, mechanism of bone destruction, factors in determining the morphology of periodontal disease, and differentiate different types of bone destructive patterns. So what is periodontitis? Periodontitis, we already know, it is a multifactorial disease which is an inflammatory disease which results in destruction of bone and formation of periodontal pocket. Periodontitis is not always preceded by gingivitis. Most of the cases the disease will arrest as gingivitis and stay as gingivitis for a longer period of time. We cannot predict when it is going to change from gingivitis to periodontitis. So not all the gingival disease will progress to periodontitis, but some gingival disease may progress to periodontitis. Periodontitis is only when there is a break in the continuity of the epithelium happens and there is an apical migration of the junctional epithelium. Where till the apical migration of junctional epithelium happens, it is still called as gingivitis. Once the migration starts happening, then it moves towards periodontitis from gingivitis. The transition from gingivitis to periodontitis is associated with changes in the bacterial plaque. Most of the times it is a gram negative bacteria. There is a change from a gram positive bacterial flora to a gram negative bacterial flora during the change of gingivitis to periodontitis. In advanced stage of gingivitis, the number of motile organisms and spirochetes increases, where the number of cocci rods and straight rods decreases. That is basically the spirochetal or a gram negative anaerobic organism increases in numbers, which results in the formation of periodontal destruction. So the cellular components of the infiltrated connective tissue also changes with increasing severity of the lesion. There will be a change in the fibroblast and lymphocytes, which in stage 1 gingivitis you will see more about a fibroblast and lymphocyte type of defect, a T lymphocyte, whereas in stage 4 it changes to a plasma cell or a B lymphocyte type of lesion. So once it changes into a plasma cell or a mast cell type of lesion, then the disease start progressing. There will be bone loss and tissue loss happens. So this we know, the pathogenesis, the stages of gingivitis are initial, early, established and advanced stages. Most of the time the gingivitis stays at gingivitis. Even in advanced lesions, there will not be any active pocket formation happens. The advanced lesion may stay as an advanced lesion for a longer duration of time without any detection or detachment in the attachment between the junctional epithelium and the CEJ. Only when there is a break in the continuity between the junctional epithelium and the CEJ and there is an apical migration of the junctional epithelium, then it is called as periodontitis. Not all advanced cases of gingivitis progress to periodontitis. Some may progress to periodontitis. Right, so according to a study, it states that T lymphocytes cases will stay as gingivitis, but when the lesion become a B lymphocyte lesion, it may be more destructive and result in initiation of periodontitis. So in the last class, we have seen what is pocket formation, how pocket formation occurs. We have seen the two mechanism how the pocket formation occurs. One mechanism where there is an increase in the polymorphonuclear neutrophils which comes out from through the junctional epithelium into the sulcus when there is increase in the number of PMNs which is counts more than 60%, then there will be break in the continuity of the epithelial attachment. The other model is when there is an inflammation, there will be destruction of collagen apical to the junctional epithelium, which results in formation of a void space apical to the junctional epithelium, whereby the junctional epithelium starts migrate apically. This is the mechanism, basically the pocket formation occurs. Why we are talking about pocket formation here? Without pocket formation, there will not be any bone destruction. Most of the time, there will be pocket along with bone destruction, with some exceptions like trauma from occlusion. Trauma from occlusion is a case where the pocket formation can happen without a bone loss can happen without a pocket formation. Whereas most of the disease, there will be pocket formation concomitant with the bone loss. So we have to know the pocket, how pocket formation occurs. Basically, the inflammation present in the sulcus which goes into the pocket or in the sulcus or through the blood vessels, it enters into the circulation and goes directly to the bone and result in bone destruction. So that is the basic idea of how bone destruction happens. So what is the radius of bone destruction? How much the bone destruction can happen? For a bone destruction to happen, there should be the initiating factors. The initiating factors, either the bacteria or its endotoxins, should be present at a specific space to induce bone formation, bone resorption. Basically, with a study, they have seen that there should be a initiating factor or a bacterial plaque should be present within 1.5 to 2.5 millimeters from the bone to induce bone destruction. If the bacteria is present away or more than 2.5 millimeter distance from the bone, then bone destruction will not happen. Basically, for a bone to destruct, the endotoxin should present in a nearby place. That is the basic idea of how bone destruction happens. Without an initiating factor, bone destruction will not happen. That is what the radius of action. So each and every bacteria have its own radius. So the bacteria, the periodontal pathogens, have an effect only within 2.5 millimeters of its circumference. More than that, it will not have any effect. So the bacteria or its endotoxin should present within that 2.5 mm radius of bone to induce bone destruction. Right. So the locally produced resorption factors may need to be present in the proximity of the bone surface to extend their actions. So a study by Page and Schroeder postulated that there should be at least 1.5 to 2.5 millimeter distance for the bacterial plaque to be present to induce bone destruction. Most of the times, if the interproximal bone is less than 2.5 millimeter in width, there will be entire bone will be lost. So there will not be any angular bone defect. It will be an horizontal bone defect if the interdental bone, the interdental septal bone, is less than 2.5 millimeter in width. If the interdental bone width is more than 2.5 millimeter, then the bone loss will be more towards an angular bone loss rather than an horizontal bone loss. Right? So what is the rate of bone loss? How much is the bone loss going to happen? If a bacteria is present, what is the rate? What is the progression of bone loss? According to a study, it stated that in an annual basis, normal bone loss happening is about 0.1 to 0.2 3 millimeters, not more than that, about 0.2 millimeter an ear on the facial surface and about 0.3 millimeters in the proximal surface. This is the normal bone loss. There will be bone loss even in normal circumstances, which is opposed by bone deposition. The bone loss and bone deposition will be equally compromised in healthy individuals. The amount of bone lost will be opposed by new bone formation. So there will, we will not be able to see any defect or bone loss in a normal population. Whereas in disease case, what happens is the bone loss exceeds the bone apposition, or there is no bone apposition happens, only the loss of bone happens because of the inflammation. That is why there is a bone loss in disease case. So on a study based on Low et al., they have found out that approximately 8% of the patients have a rapid bone loss, an aggressive type of bone loss, which accounts up to 0.1 to 1 millimeter per year. The bone loss can happen even 1 millimeter per year. That is a case of aggressive periodontitis, where it most frequently happens in 8% of the population, whereas in 81% of the population, the bone loss is moderate, which happens from 0.05 millimeter to 0.5 millimeter per year, whereas the remaining 11% of the person's population will have very minimal bone loss, which is 0.05 to 0.09 millimeter per year, which is really very less. So we are worried about this 81% of individuals who is going to have 0.5 millimeter of bone loss per year if it is untreated, the periodontitis is untreated, and we are more worried about the aggressive periodontitis case or rapidly progressing periodontitis case, where there will be 1 millimeter of bone loss, 1 to 2 millimeter of bone loss per year happens. That is, the rate of bone loss depends on the type of periodontal disease. So the period of destruction, what is the period of destruction? Whether it is going to happen continuously? No, the periodontal disease is not a continuous process. It is an episodic process. There will be an active phase where there is active bone loss happens, and suddenly it goes to an inactive phase or a quiescence, where it will be in an inactive state for a longer period of time. It may be 3 months, it may be 6 months, it may be 1 year. Again, it can come back to an active phase, or it may not come back to an active phase. Again, the problem with periodontal disease is we don't know when it will be in inactive phase, when it will be in active phase. We couldn't able to predict when the patient will go into an active phase from an inactive phase, or whether the patient is from an active phase, whether it will go for an inactive phase or not. Because the active phase, the extent of activity and extent of inactivity cannot be determined, because we don't know how the individual, each and every individual, reacts to a specific pathogen in a different manner. So it is very difficult for the periodontist to identify whether this patient is going to have an active burst of disease or not. So the disease can be inactive for a longer time. If it is treated, it can be even maintained at an inactive period over the period of the entire life also. So basically, there are 4 theories on the onset and destruction of periodontal disease. So one theory states that there is an gingival ulceration which results in pocket formation. This pocket formation is in accordance with bone destruction, a burst in destructive activity associated with subgingival ulcerations and an acute inflammatory reactions result in rapid loss of bone. So the pocket formation is coincide with bone loss. That is one theory. The other theory states that when there is a change in the bacterial plaque from a gram positive to a gram negative organisms, which will result in more bone loss. Until it was a gram positive organism, there is no bone loss happens. Once there is a gram negative flora changes, the gram positive flora changes to a gram negative flora, there will be an active bone loss or bone destruction starts happening. That is one more theory. The third theory states that the host responds. Till it was a T lymphocyte response to the bacteria, there is no bone destruction. But when the response by the host from a T lymphocyte to a B lymphocyte type of response, then it become a destructive type of bone or destructive type of disease which results in bone destruction happens. The fourth theory states that because of the invasion of the bacteria, the periodontal pathogens are tissue invasives. So these bacteria can invade into the tissue. Once it invades or go into the tissue, these bacteria can able to produce endotoxins and release endotoxins. So once this tissue invasive bacterial species are identified, there is bone loss happens. So this theory states that whenever there is a tissue invasive bacteria is present, the bacteria can able to destroy the bone. These are all the four different theories of onset of destructive periods in periodontal bone destruction. So we don't know exactly when all this going to happen, whether any one of this is going to be responsible or all factors is going to be responsible for the bone loss, right? Coming on to the factor determining the bone morphology, the pattern of bone morphology or bone is determined by various factors. For example, and some normal variants can also have a change in the bone morphology. For example, the thickness of the bone, the width of the interdental bone, the crestal angular bone or angulation of the interdental bone, the thickness of the facial and lingual alveolar bone, the presence of whether any fenestration or dehiscence, the thinness of the bone or alignment of the teeth, root and root trunk anomalies, all this can have a role in determining the morphology of the bone. Other than this, even an exostosis can change the morphology of the bone. A trauma from occlusion can change the morphology of the bone. Buttressing bone formation can change the morphology of the bone. A food impaction can alter the morphology. An aggressive periodontitis can alter the morphology of the bone. We'll see one by one how it is going to modify the or determine the morphology of the bone. In normal variants, what are all the considerable normal variants which exist in changing the morphology of the bone pattern is the thickness, width and crestal angulation of the interdental bone, the thickness of the facial and lingual alveolar plates, the presence of fenestration and dehiscence, the alignment of the teeth, root and root trunk anatomy, root position within the alveolar process, proximity of the another tooth surface. For example, if the adjacent tooth are too close to each other, the bone may not be present in the interdental region because the tooth is more adjacent to each other, so that the periodontal ligament will be present and result in bone destruction, or there will not be any bone, or very thin amount of interproximal bone will be present. These are all normal variants we can see in patients. This cannot be taken as a disease because of the root proximity, right? So that is one of the example. The other possible ways which is going to determine the morphology of the bone are exostosis. We know, we have seen exostosis like palatal torre or maxillary torre or a mandibular torre. You can see a bulbous bone formation which rounden the supporting alveolar bone. You will see more exostosis seen in the alveolar bone. So that is one type of change in the morphology of the bone that cannot be taken as a pathogenesis or a pathology of a bone pattern. Other forms are buttressing bone formation. Buttressing bone formation sometimes occurs to an attempt for bony trabecular in a weakened resorption regions. During a bone resorption, there will be bone apposition, should happen. Whenever there is a bone resorption, the bone will be replaced by a new bone. The old bone will be removed and new bone will be replaced. In some cases, the new bone cannot be replaced in the same place where the bone was lost. Instead of that, the bone will be replaced in a peripheral region, which results in a peripheral buttressing bone formation, or it can be replaced in the center of the bone trabecule, which is a central buttressing bone formation, instead of the position where the bone loss happens. That is one form of morphological change. The other form is trauma from occlusion. A trauma from occlusion can change the bone morphology. Most of the time it increase the thickness of the alveolar plate and rounden the alveolar plate, which results in more food accumulation. That is the problem with trauma from occlusion. Food impaction is one of the ways which can able to change the morphology of the bone. The interdental bone defects often occurs when proximal contact is abnormal or absent. The pressure or pressure and the irritation because of the food impaction will result in the bone loss, which results in an inverted architecture or a crater formation in the interdental regions can happen. Between the facial and lingual plate, the interdental bone will be lost to result in a crater formation. That is possible in food impaction. Again, aggressive periodontitis, the pattern of bone is completely different from all the other patterns, where only molar and incisors will be involved, and there will be more aggressive type of bone loss, which results in an arc-shaped bone loss and a bilateral mirror-like pattern. So one side molar is affected, the opposite side molar also affected in the same way with an arc-shaped defect. That is the morphological changes in aggressive periodontitis. Coming on to the patterns of bone destructions, we have seen the with a different morphological changes how different things can affect the morphology of the bone. Now we'll see the different patterns of bone destruction. What are all the different patterns of bone destructions? It starts with architectural changes. Usually the interdental bone is coronal to the facial and lingual cortical bone. The interdental crestal bone is coronal to the facial and lingual crestal cortical bone. That is positive architecture. This architecture change during disease, what happens is either the interdental bone comes up to the level of the facial and lingual bone, or it can go below the or apical to the facial and lingual bone. The interdental bone can go apical to the facial and lingual bone, resulting in flat architecture or a negative architecture. That is the change in the architecture of the bone. Next is an horizontal bone loss. Horizontal bone loss, we know there is reduction in the height of the bone from the CJ. Usually in a normal person, the bone, the crest of alveolar bone should be present 1 to 2 millimeter from the cemento enamel junction. If it is going apical to that region, then it is an horizontal bone loss. Whereas angular bone loss or a vertical bone loss occurs in an oblique directions, leaving a hollow out on the other side of the bone. So again, the vertical bone loss can be subdivided into osseous defects. The osseous defects can be supra-bony defects or intra-bony defects or interradicular defects. The supra-bony defects going to be an horizontal type of defects, whereas intra-bony defects or angular defects is further subdivided into one wall defect, two wall defect and three wall defect, or combination of these three. One wall defect is when there is only one wall is intact and other three walls are lost. That is one wall defect. One wall is intact and other three walls are lost. So only one wall is present. Either it may be a distal wall or a mesial wall or a buccal wall or a lingual wall. Right? In a two-wall defect, it limits to two osseous walls present from the tooth surface. Two walls will be present and other two walls have been lost. Most frequently, the walls which is lost is a facial wall and the interdental wall. Tooth surface wall and a facial wall are the most frequently lost walls, and the mesial or distal wall and the lingual wall will be intact. Three wall defect is when three walls are present and one wall is missing. This most of the time, the third wall which is going to be the fourth wall which is going to be missing is a tooth surface wall. The tooth surface wall is lost and the facial, lingual and mesial or distal wall is intact. That is three wall defect. Combined osseous defect is the defect where it is a combination of any of this. Either two wall present with the third wall, half of the wall is present and half is absent, or there is an one wall defect from the cervical region to the middle third, and there is a three wall defect from the middle to the apical third, or it may be two wall in one side or three wall in other side. This can happen. That is the combined osseous defects. The other type of wall defects or bone destruction pattern is osseous crater. I already told you what is osseous crater is. During infant impaction, there will be interdental alveolar bone loss with intact facial and lingual wall, which results in an apical movement of the interproximal bone without a loss of facial and lingual cortical bone, which results in a crater formation in the interdental region alone. Right? Whereas intrabony defect, there will be a root surface wall which is lost. But most frequently, because of the food impaction, you see a crater formation. The reason for high frequency of crater is the interdental area which collects more amount of plaque and very difficult to clean. A normal flat or even concave facio-lingual shape and the interdental septa is in septum of the lower molars may favor the formation of crater, or a vascular pattern of the gingiva where the vascular pattern moves towards the interdental region, which results in the inflammation, moving the inflammation to the interdental region, can result in crater bone loss. The other types of bone loss are ramps. Ramp is a type of bone loss when there is a bone loss happens with irregular in shape. Yeah, bone loss, alveolar bone and its supporting bone loss, that which is lost to a degree in such a manner that the margins of the deformity are at different level. For example, the facial bone level is more coronal compared to the interproximal bone level. That is ramps. Whereas planes are more towards an horizontal type of bone loss, where the bone loss happens, both the supporting bone as well as the alveolar bone loss happens at the same degree, where the deformity happens at the same level. That is planes. Whereas reverse architecture, we already told you what is reverse architecture. The interproximal bone or interdental crestal alveolar bone goes apical to the facial and lingual cortical bone. That is reverse architecture. Or it may be an hemiseptal defect. Hemiseptal defect is an one wall defect. It is a type of one wall defect where only one side of the tooth, for example, on the distal aspect of a tooth, you will see a hemiseptal defect where only one wall is present, whereas on the mesial aspect of the tooth, there is no bone loss. That is hemiseptal defect. Bulbous bony contours, the defects like exostosis and buttressing bone formation result in bulbous bony contour, more commonly seen in maxilla than in mandible. Ledges, it's a type of intrabony defect, whereas one wall, two wall, three wall defects, we have talked about the intrabony defect on the interproximal region. Ledges is a type of a three wall defect on a facial or a lingual bone. For example, the outer cortical plate of the facial bone is intact, whereas the tooth surface cortical plate is lost, which results in a thin line of bone on the buccal or on the lingual side, with there is a bone loss in the between the tooth and the facial bone. That is what called as ledges. And the final part of the class is furcation involvement. Furcation involvement, again, it can be a bone loss which is either an horizontal type or a vertical type of bone loss. So Glickman classified the horizontal type of bone loss into four grades: grade 1, grade 2, grade 3, grade 4. Grade 1 is an incipient or a early stage of lesion where the furcation is not involved, but the bone loss extends up to the furcation but not involving the furcation. It is grade 1. Whereas grade 2, it affects one or more furcation, but it is not through and through. There is no communication between the furcation on the other side. The bone loss happens in the furcation region, either in the trifurcation or bifurcation region, but there is no communication between one furcation to the other furcation in the bifurcation defect or a trifurcation defect. That is grade 2, otherwise called as cul-de-sac. Grade 3 is a through and through defect. You insert a probe on one side of the furcation, the probe can come out of the other side of the furcation. That is grade 3. But the difference between grade 3 and grade 4 is, in grade 3 furcation involvement, there will be soft tissue covering the furcation region. Whereas in grade 4, the furcation is clinically exposed. You can able to clinically visualize the furcation. The gingival tissue loss also happens. There is no gingiva going to cover the furcation. So the furcation is clinically visible, is called as grade 4. Both are through and through defects. This is classified by Glickman. The other type of classification is given by Hamp. He classified based on the depth of furcation, the amount of penetration of the probe. He classified into class 1, class 2, class 3. Again, it is an horizontal classification. If the probe can penetrate less than 3 mm on the horizontal attachment, then it is class 1. If it moves more than 3 mm on the horizontal component, it is class 2. And if there is a through and through furcation involvement, it is class 3. This is a classification given by Hamp. The third type of classification is given by Tarno. It is basically the horizontal component was Glickman's component. So he follows Glickman's horizontal component and given subclass for the vertical component. The subclass he have given for vertical component into subclass A, B and C. So subclass A is the furcation involvement, the horizontal furcation involvement with vertical component which is less than 3 mm. The vertical bone loss is less than 3 mm is classified as subclass A. Vertical component between 4 to 6 mm is classified as subclass B. And if the vertical component is more than 7 mm, it is classified as subclass C. This is vertical component, classification of furcation based on the vertical component. So we have seen today the different how bone loss happens, what is the different patterns of bone loss, and what is the different modes or factors which is going to influence on the bone loss. To conclude, the amplification and propagation of the inflammatory response through the gingival tissue is critical to the pathogenesis of periodontitis. However, it is the spread of the response to area adjacent to the alveolar bone that derives the cellular machinery involving the bone loss. Deciding on the diagnosis has several practical purposes. It sets as a stage or context for treatment planning. It helps in establishing an outcome and it facilitates communication with colleague and patients. That is the main role of identifying the pattern of bone destruction. So how we are going to identify the bone loss most frequently? By radiographs. We have to take a radiograph to identify, or we have to do a careful probing. The best method of identifying the type of bone loss is surgical exposure. You can able to clearly visualize the type of bone loss only in surgical exposure or a 3D scan, rather than taking a radiograph. Radiograph is a two-dimensional picture which will not show you what type of bone loss happens inside, what pattern of bone loss is happened, unless until you open up surgically to visualize the bone. So today's class we have seen the various patterns of bone destruction, starts from architectural changes, horizontal bone loss, vertical or angular bone losses, bulbous bony contour, ledges and furcation involvement. Thank you.